Hi, I'm Carrie. Welcome to worship with Bethel International United Methodist Church for April 26th. You know, I just checked and it's still true. Hope has not been canceled. Today we're going to hear what the prophet Jeremiah said to his people, Israel, in their hardest time. He said, "I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. Prepare now your hearts and minds for a message of hope, which most certainly has not been canceled."
Thank you.
Before we get any further today in our service, let us get settled together in our focus on our mission and our vision, which we'll read aloud together. Our mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And our vision is to be an amazingly international church where faith is contagious and invitational. So, our offering. It's time for the offering, sort of. On the screen, you'll see a summary of ways to support Bethel financially at this time. We'll show the screen again at the end of worship today. We understand that these are challenging and uncertain times for many families, and our staff and finance team have reduced spending in many ways. Yet expenses do continue, and your pastors and staff are working harder than ever. So thank you for giving all you can during this hard time, and for taking a moment to identify the best way for you to give. Check, text, website, EFT, bill pay. Oh, the wonders of technology. Coming up this Thursday, we've got our community dinner on Thursday, April 30th. You can drive up or walk up for a takeout meal. If you'd like to help safely prepare or deliver the meals, please contact the church. Now, Pastor Glenn will lead us in the call to worship.
Will you please join with me in our call to worship from Psalm 33? I'll say the lines for the leader. Please join with me in the lines for the people. Our soul waits for the Lord, who is our help and shield. Our heart is glad in the Lord, because we trust in God's holy name. Let all your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, for our hope is in you. As we go to God in prayer today, I want to share with you some words of prayer by an Australian writer named Julie Perrin. Then we'll pray together our breakthrough prayer and the Lord's Prayer. Will you bow with me in prayer? God of those who are numbed, stunned by loss, enfold us in a gentle darkness, a hidden sleep, a long stillness. Remember us to ourselves. Awaken the courage we'd forgotten we had. Fierce lover of life, give strength to our arms and our resolve. Critical is this time for cleaning, swabbing, scrubbing, and washing our hands again and again and again. Let us join ourselves to the task with readiness, steadiness, clarity, because we too love life, our own, and our neighbors. Will you pray with me our breakthrough prayer? O God, we ask you to break through today to heal and save your people. Break through with wisdom for everyone making state and national decisions. Break through with strength for all who are working to keep us healthy, fed, and safe. Break through to make us kind and compassionate in the midst of fear and uncertainty. Break through to show us how our church can be your hands and feet in this time of need. Break through to do through us more than we could ever ask, think, or imagine. In Christ's name, amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
All right, everybody, gather those children. It's time to listen to Miss Sarah.
Hi, everyone. It's great to be with you this morning. So a few years ago, my family planned a trip to San Francisco in California. We'd never been, and we were so excited. When we got there, we decided to pick up a few maps. We looked at those maps, and we figured out a plan, kind of where we wanted to eat, places we wanted to visit, and places to shop, of course. And that worked out really well for us. So also we carried that map around in case we got lost. Well, that plan though, didn't always work like we thought it was going to. One day, for example, when we went to get lunch, the place was closed. So we kind of asked around and found a different place. And you know what? That place turned out to be great. And we were kind of glad that the original plan didn't work out. Did you know that God has a plan for you? That's right. God has a plan for your life and my life, everyone's life. Now, it's not written out on paper like this. We can't see it. Only God knows that plan. And sometimes that plan may not be exactly what we think it should be. And sometimes that plan doesn't always reveal itself when we think it should. But what we do know about that plan is that we should follow it and we should trust in God, because God's plan is always the best for us. I know those times when I have tried to just, do things on my own, or, you know what, I'm not going to wait to figure out what God wants me to do. I'm just going to do it myself. No, that turned out to be not so great. So even in these times where things are a little different, we're not quite sure what's going on, we do need to trust and know that God has a plan, and God's plan is the best. And that plan gives me great hope and great hope for my future. Have a great week. I'll see you soon.
Our scripture reading today comes from Jeremiah. It is chapter 29, verses 10 through 14. For thus says the Lord, only when Babylon's 70 years are completed will I visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. Then, when you call upon me and come and pray to me, I will hear you. When you search for me, you will find me. If you seek me with all your heart, I will let you find me, says the Lord. And I will restore your fortunes and gather you from all nations and all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord. And I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile. It's the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Joseph took his wife.
Our worship series is called Hope Is Not Canceled. And last Sunday, we walked the road to Emmaus, which is the road you walk when you've given up hope, and yet somehow the risen Jesus just keeps showing up. In weeks to come, we will see how to get to hope, we will invest in hope, and we'll suss out where is the source of hope. But for today, we start with this. There's a difference between hope and optimism. Now, admittedly, the Old Testament prophet Jeremiah, he would never be mistaken for an optimist. He spread so much doom and gloom around that the king of Israel finally had him put in jail, just so he wouldn't have to listen to him anymore. Jeremiah is often called, he's often portrayed as the weeping prophet, as crying over the state of his people. Our English word, Jeremiah, refers to a speech that is long and sad and full of woe. Jeremiah relentlessly prophesied that for his people, things were going to get worse and worse and finally come apart altogether. Jeremiah foretold the defeat of Israel in battle. He foretold the destruction of Jerusalem and of the temple. And he said that the leading people would be taken away into exile in Babylon, and every one of the disasters Jeremiah foretold all came to pass. But when things had come apart, when the destruction was complete, then suddenly, miraculously, Jeremiah became a prophet of hope. He announced to the exiles, to those people who had been ripped away from their families and their homes, he said, I have something to tell you, that the future is full of hope. He said, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm. I am going to give you a future with hope. After the defeat and dejection of his people, Jeremiah's heart was always with the exiles. He wanted to go to Babylon and live amongst the exiles, but he was not allowed to do that. And so he wrote a series of letters to the exiles. One of them is reported in Jeremiah 29. And here's what Jeremiah said to the exiles. Here was his advice for them. He said, you should build houses for yourselves in Babylon, plant gardens and fields. He says you should get married, have children in Babylon. Don't listen to those false prophets, the ones saying, oh, this will all blow over in a couple of months, maybe a year, because it won't, he said. Most of you are going to spend the rest of your lives in exile in Babylon. So here is one lesson about hope from the prophet Jeremiah. When things are really bad, people of hope accept the situation and find a way to make the best of it. Hope does not consist of ignoring evidence that you do not like. Hope does not consist of downplaying how bad things are. That's called wishful thinking. It's called false hope. Rather, in the hardest of times, people of hope accept the things they cannot change, and they find a way to live with faithfulness and even joy in the midst of those times. So, if the exiles couldn't get back home, and they couldn't, well, then the next best thing was to make Babylon as much like home as possible. And if you can't go to school, well, the next best thing is to learn everything you can online. If you can't leave your home, well, some people are doing spring cleaning, right? Some people are doing fix-up projects. Some people, I hear, are catching up on their daily blueprint Bible readings. You know, in hard times, hope accepts the situation and finds a way to make the best of it. Jeremiah is saying that there is a difference between hope and mere optimism. Optimism is the idea that things are about to turn around, things are getting better and better every day. Optimism believes that if I can just get the right job, if I can just pick the right stock, if I can just start over again, maybe everything will be better this time. That's optimism, and there's nothing wrong with optimism. Truth is, throughout my life, I've been trying to learn how to be more optimistic, kind of less of a Debbie Downer. There's nothing wrong with optimism, except it's not enough. Because sometimes things are not getting better. Some things, if you try it again, it still doesn't work. That was the first part of Jeremiah's message to the exiles. This, he said, is not a time for optimism, because it doesn't matter what you do. You are going to spend the rest of your lives in Babylon. No, he says, this is not a time for optimism. This is a time for deep hope. In the book that I've been recommending to you, it's called Standing on the Promises. Standing on the Promises. Lewis Smead says that the main difference between hope and optimism is primarily one of degree. Of greater staying power of hope, that hope can keep going when optimism has given up. If you're running a spiritual marathon, well, optimism might get you 8 or 10 miles down the road, but it takes hope to get all the way to the finish line. Hope is that conviction deep down inside of you that everything is going to turn out all right, and that if it doesn't, God is somehow going to make it all right anyway. There is a difference between hope and mere optimism. So that's one lesson in hope from the prophet Jeremiah. Here's another lesson from Jeremiah. Hope is always rooted in the past faithfulness of God. Hope is always oriented towards the future. But hope can only be lived out today. Here's what I mean. You know, some people think that hope has to be based on evidence, on these observable signs of improvement. But again, that's more like optimism than hope. I mean, what do you do if there aren't any signs of improvement? Does that mean you can't have hope? No, here's how Paul puts it in Romans. He says, now hope that is seen is not hope. He asks, who hopes for what they can see? But if we hope for what we cannot see, he says, then we wait for it with patience. That's hope. Other people believe that hope is just built into the human spirit. Lewis Smedes believes this to some extent, and I suppose it's true. But if it's true that hope is built into the human spirit, well, it seems like maybe there was a construction problem with the hope built into my human spirit. You know, I'm sure God made me to be hopeful, but in my darkest times, I sure would hate to have to get by on the hope I can dredge up out of my own spirit. Here's what I want to tell you. Hope is not grounded in evidence, and hope is not grounded in the human spirit. Hope is rooted in the faithfulness of God. Just as God has saved and delivered and comforted us before, so will God save and deliver and comfort us again. After all, our God is the God that rescued Noah from the flood. Our God is the God that brought the people out of slavery in Egypt, that delivered Daniel from the lion's den. For heaven's sakes, our God is the God who raised Jesus from the dead. And our God is the one who has brought all of us this far on the way. You see, the Babylonian exile was not the first hard time our God had faced. And this coronavirus crisis, this is not the hardest crisis that our God has faced. People who have been around a while, they know that. In our Lenten study book, the book that we tried to study during the season of Lent, the author Adam Hamilton refers to some research that shows that older adults actually report being happier than younger adults. And one reason for that is, well, they've been through a few things before. And older people tend not to let hard times overwhelm them. My wife's family has started having video chats every weekend, and her dad, my father-in-law, who acknowledges he qualifies now as an older adult, I hear him just always trying to reassure his family. Every weekend, he says, you know, we're going to get through this. This won't go on forever. Things will get back to normal again. Don't give up hope. And then he says, here's what I want to do. I want to plan a family cruise for when all this is over. Well, sign me up, you know. He's been through some things before. Hope is rooted in the knowledge that God has saved us before, and surely God can save us again. Hope is rooted in the past faithfulness of God, but hope is always oriented to the future. You remember what Jeremiah said? He said, I know the plans I have for you, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you what? To give you a future with hope. Hope declares that however bad things used to be, however bad things still might be, God is doing a new thing, and God is letting us catch a glimpse of it before it even takes place. You know, it's sort of natural for people like me who are middle-aged, you might say middle-aged and then some, it's natural for us to try to hope by looking back at the past. We remember the good old days, some golden age before bad things had happened, when churches were full, when life was simple. But the only problem with that is, you know, time only runs in one direction. Even if the good old days really were good, well, there isn't any way to get back to them. You can only move ahead. So, when the exiles finally did get back from Babylon to their native land, and they did finally get back, turns out, well, it wasn't the same as it used to be. I mean, it was still good in a different way. It was still holy, but it wasn't what it used to be. Hope is oriented towards the future. When I was brand new at one of the churches I used to serve, early on, we had a leadership retreat day, brought in a consultant to work with us, and right away that consultant kind of had us go to different sides of the room. She had people go to this side of the room if they believed that the best days of that church were in the past. And she had us go to the other side of the room if we believed that the best days of that church were still ahead of us. I instantly knew we were in a lot of trouble, but I also knew that we weren't quite done for yet. Everybody went to the side of the room for the best days of the church are behind us, with the exception of two young women who somehow thought God wasn't done with us yet. And with those two young women and their vision, God built a vibrant, hopeful future for that church. You see, hope has to be oriented to the future. If we don't have a picture of what God is doing, if we don't have a notion of where God is leading us, well, it's pretty hard to go on. There isn't anything to go on for. Hope is oriented towards the future. So, to review, hope is rooted in the past faithfulness of God. Hope is always oriented towards the future. But hope can only be lived out today. If hope just looks back all the time, that's just sentimental. And if hope is only looking forward all the time, well, that's just pie in the sky. Hope has to be lived out today. Remember what Jeremiah said? He said, I'm going to give you a future with hope, but in the meantime, plant a garden, have a family. In other words, get a life today. Hope isn't just sitting around remembering how good things used to be. And hope isn't just sitting around thinking how good things might be someday. Hope has to be lived today. So, hope trusts in the faithfulness of God in the past. Hope knows that God isn't done with us yet. And in the meantime, hope is lived every day in the goodness and the love and the mercy of Almighty God. I've asked some friends to join me in sharing with you today a hymn of hope. It's called, O God, Our Help in Ages Past.
O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come. Be thou our guide while life shall last, and our eternal home.
Under the shadow of thy throne, still may we dwell secure. Sufficient is thine arm alone, and our defense is sure.
Thousand ages in thy sight are like an evening gone. Short as the watch that ends the night before the rising sun.
Time like an ever-rolling stream bears all who breathe away. They fly forgotten as a dream dies at the opening day.
O God, our help in ages past, our hope for you.
years to come. Be thou our guide while life shall last, and our eternal home.
There is a difference between hope and optimism. Hope keeps on going when optimism has given up. We hope, finally, because we know that God has delivered us in the past. We hope because God has promised us a new and glorious future, and we live out that hope always today. Here's what Jeremiah said. He said, "Here are the plans I have for you, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope." Rest assured, my friends, hope has not been canceled.
Jesus Christ, thy living God.
We thank you, Lord, for reigniting within us the flame of hope. Go now as light bearers to a world of darkness. Go now as hope bearers to a world in despair. Thanks be to God. Amen.